So hello everyone, my name is Dhruva Jyoti. I'm a PhD student working with Professor Anish Arora at Ohio State University. Before we tell you about what we explored as part of this workshop, I would like to give you an overview of the problems that we were interested in. So we have traditionally done shallow machine learning on Mote scale and slightly larger, maybe SoC scale devices. One of the devices that we have developed is a 50 milliwatt pulse Doppler radar that is integrated with a 64 megahertz Cortex M3 Mote. This is what we call the Bumblebee radar and a .NOW board. When an object displaces in front of the radar, even though it cannot do absolute ranging, what it can do is it can figure out the displacement of the object and create what we call a cut for the duration of the object's displacement that is visible by the radar. Through analysis of the cuts, we have traditionally designed some engineered features in amplitude space and in amplitude phase and joint time frequency domain over the duration of the displacement. For detection of objects such as humans, cows, cars, etc., we have traditionally relied on an RBF kernel SVM using 12 features downselected from a bigger list of like 90 or 100 features. It currently has 94.6% accuracy for object detection, object classification. However, it comes with the huge overhead of A, storing the support vectors, which alone consumes 30 kilobytes, and B, feature computation, in fact, consumes more than 90% of the end-to-end classification cycle. So if the classifier is, we cannot really, our features are such that we need a substantial length of the cut to be processed in order to generate them, because they are statistics built on time. And therefore, 90% or more of the full classification cycle is consumed by feature computation. So these are essentially the two tall poles, and we were really motivated to try out feature learning techniques instead of feature engineering techniques to see if we can mitigate them. Before coming here, we did experiments with bonsai. We found that it gave us 95.2% accuracy. It only consumed 2 kilobytes of memory, which was a big win in terms of the classifier size. But the caveat was still that we had to compute engineered features. The second application we're interested in, along with our partners at New York University, is deploying a sensor network comprised of the nodes that you see here. They are slightly bigger than the Mote I showed you in the previous slide. These are more like wearable scale, but not quite. The devices are custom built for this project. They have an application processing unit, a microprocessor, and a microcontroller in decreasing order of power. And there's a 1 megabyte on-chip RAM. And the objective of this project is to classify noise complaints in New York City in real time, so that a real-time actuation can be done on them. Because a city, an urban canyon, is a highly variable and dynamic environment, and the noise conditions, the background conditions, the noise intensity, etc., are all extremely variable based on where you place the devices. None of the existing smaller data sets of non-speech sounds were really enough to train it, which is why we relied on a corpus built from the Google data set to train what we call the look, listen, and learn audio embedding that came out from Google last year. So here what we do is we train an audio subnetwork and a video subnetwork together and learn the association between them. Are they related or not? For example, this is an audio clip from a guitar, and this is a picture of a guitar. Are they related or not? The advantage is that there is no need for explicit labeling, something that we lack in huge quantities of sound data that we have collected. But we are also implicitly grouping similar audios together. And finally, we cut out this audio subnetwork, apply it to some smaller downstream data sets, such as DKs or the urban sound, and use that as an embedding with a small MLP classifier. Here the tall poles are that the embedding alone, the audio embedding alone, is 56 megabytes. It's pretty huge. It can never fit onto the 500 kilobyte budget that we have on these devices, which is why we were motivated to try several techniques to see how we could shrink them. So in pursuing these two directions, we have designed a few experiments in the workshop that we wanted to explore and get results from, so that they would set the foundation for the next steps in our research. So Pranchu would next speak about the experiments in the radar domain, which involves RNNs. Thank you.
Hey, everyone. So basically, the thing was that, as Dhruva pointed out, our objective was to try out the RNN on the human non-human data set to see whether we can get a competitive accuracy while getting rid of the cost of feature computation, which was present there in SVM bonsai technique. So the thing is, the way the RNN construct works is that let's just say that you have a certain batch on which you're training. The RNN, it's supposed to roll over to a fixed number of time steps. The caveat here is that all our cuts, they obviously are of different length. One is of 2 seconds, one is of 5 seconds, one is of 10 seconds, and so on and so forth. So one way to tackle with this problem was that instead of training directly on the cuts, you actually artificially create, you can say, a training data set by taking windows out of the cut with an appropriate stride, create a, both a training and a testing data set, train on the training data set, classify on the testing, you can say, data set. And for getting the accuracy on a test, you can say, cut, basically for all the windows which have been created for this, you can say, test cut, do something like, you can say, majority prediction. So when we tried out this approach, the problem was that for the test cuts, which had, you can say, relatively shorter length of, you can say, 2 seconds or even lower, the accuracy was relatively poor. So we are only able to, you can say, reach an accuracy of roughly around about 94.8% only on the cuts, which were, you can say, greater than.
What are you cutting?
Basically, a cut, a data file.
So, how is this related to the previous two slides? Which application are you looking at? So
this is related to the radar application. When an object displaces in front of the radar, we have a displacement detector that cuts out the section of the ambient that corresponds to the displacement of the object. We refer to that as a cut. Sorry for not clarifying this.
So basically, as I mentioned, the problem with this approach was that the test cuts of a short duration, the accuracy on them was relatively poor. And also there was a, yeah. So basically, we tried out a second approach, or we can say dynamic RNN, which had the flexibility that even if the cuts were of varying length in the training data set, it would unroll to the number of times of any specific, you can say, cut. Here the first risk was that on the test cut, if you take the longest length, it was, you can say, exorbitantly long, of, you can say, 1 hour and an RNN, it's very difficult to train as you increase the number of time steps. So what we did was we took a subcut length from each cut, and we had this thing that in case if a cut does not have the length equal to the subcut length, just simply pad it to become equal to that. And now train directly on the cuts rather than any artificial, you can say, data set, and classify directly also on the test cuts themselves. This was giving a pretty competitive accuracy of 96.5%. And also we removed that restriction that the test cuts, they have to be greater than a certain length, like 2.5 seconds. This is for all the possible, you can say, test cuts. So I've mentioned like some of the figures here. So you can see that the model size, it's reasonably competitive if you compare, especially with the SVM of 5.7 kb in comparison to 30 kb. It's larger than the bonsai, but the thing is that we've gotten rid of the feature, that computation, the thing. So this is a pretty good result because this illustrates that without resorting to, you can say, more complicated techniques like dual RNN, and by avoiding feature computation, we can get a good accuracy with relatively low model size. So these are some of the advantages. As I mentioned, that only a fixed subcut of approximately 2 seconds is required. This makes way for faster classification, no stacking, this thing, and the verifier, this is more efficient. So extending this thing for the activity data set, which is patently a harder task than the human versus non-human, we tried out, you can say, a number of techniques, like, you can say, SVM, bonsai, deep bonsai, and this thing. And irrespective of the technique used, it's giving an accuracy of, you can say, roughly 80%. So the one good thing which illustrated was that RNN is sort of roughly, you can say, competitive as compared to other techniques on the active data set. But the larger implication was that there's a shortage of data in this particular task and we need more data. The process of that data collection is continuing on, and I'm hopeful that in the next 1 or 2 months, we'll get that access and make better inroads in this exercise. So I'll hand back to Prabhu.
We have a C# implementation of the RNN, which is what our Mote runs on. So it uses a pared down version of Microsoft's .NET micro framework that we call the eMote, where the application programmer writes code in C#. We could not demonstrate for you today, and we apologize because we do not have the hardware board with us. It did not reach us in time. But it is developed and fully unit tested, and we can start doing field tests as soon as we get back from this workshop.
Shriram, this is the paper we've submitted to NIPS this time, and they don't focus on the classifier, so there's no proton and bonsai, but there's a completely new architecture for doing feature computation on time series.
Sorry, how much time do we have? Okay, yeah, I'll be slightly fast. So now we go to the to the Sonic project of tackling noise complaints in New York City. So to remind you of the motivation, we have to fit the system a relatively big classifier, the L3 embedding, onto a 500 kilobyte budget. So we took two directions to explore this question. One was, can RNNs work out of the box to tackle the problem? Do we even need an embedding for a non-speech acoustic events? So we tried extensively with single layered or stacked GRUs and LSTMs and some variants such as fast GRNN. We used the Urban Sound 8K dataset, which had around 200,000 training samples. I can give you some, these are some of the hyperparameters we played with and some of the model variants we played with. So in the first phase, we compute a MEL, spectrogram of 199 time steps across 256 filter banks. This is used as input to the RNN. We optionally have a second layer of RNN if we look into stacking. And finally, we have 10 output classes. So we tried various hidden dimensions, dropout rates, learning rates, et cetera, and a few variants of RNNs, such as low rank, fast gRNNs, and stacked RNNs. So we observed that the main issue with RNNs in tackling non-speech acoustic events is that they suffer from severe overfitting. And no matter what we did, we couldn't bridge the train test gap closer than 30%. For example, this is some of the best results we got using RNNs. 92% accuracy in 60 epochs, and by which time the training saturates, so we didn't really continue further. But the validation accuracy is like 63%. Even though the model sizes are sufficiently small, if it would have worked, it would have been great for us, but it didn't. And so we played around with various input representations, such as using regular spectrograms instead of MEL spectrograms. That did even worse. We found that stacking doesn't help, and fast gRNN only does marginally better because it has fewer parameters. So we have pretty much concluded that RNNs alone are not competitive with CNNs, which is why in our present exploration, where we are trying to train an equivalent student model from the L3 embedding, we did not exactly use a vanilla RNN as a candidate student model. Rather, we used a combination of convolution and recurrence. So we used, for knowledge distillation purposes, we used a variant of the student model with convolutions and another variant with RNNs as candidate models, and we trained on the same Urban Sound 8K. This is not ideal, and I'll tell you why in a second, but given the time left in the workshop, we could only train on the Urban Sound 8K. So this is an example of the student model. We are now learning from the raw sample. So if we are sampling at 48 kilohertz, this is the input. We are passing it through a layer of convolution filters, 64. And then in the CNN variant, we are passing it through a bunch of 2D convolution filters that vary from 2 to 4. In the RNN case, we are passing it through two stack layers. And again, we are mapping them to the 10 output classes. While the CNN does not give us great accuracy, in fact, it is comparable with the accuracy that we get in with the vanilla RNN approach, and it also has a fatter model, which all three of them do. We are starting to see some good results with SimpleNet GRU, the GRU variant of SimpleNet. It is 65% accuracy, and it is staying pretty constant at 62 to 65%, at least in the epochs that we have trained so far. And without any other, we are competing with the target of 77%. There is still some gap to be bridged here. However, we have trained it on one of the downstream datasets due to lack of time. This was not ideal because the L3 embedding is really trained from the big Google dataset. So one of the first tasks that we will do when we return from the workshop is to train these existing student models with the original Google data that we were used to train the L3 embedding. And we think that we should be able to get a lot more out of it at a much smaller size. The second direction that we want to explore as a next step is developing new student architectures for non-speech acoustic sensing, such as We can one of the ideas that we have been discussing is there are some existing compression techniques that reduce model size, for example, through removing redundancies in the model. One of them is called deep IoT, which leads to a good enough compression. However, it comes with the cost of accuracy drop. And we can use that as a student to buy back some of that accuracy drop, hopefully, from the original teacher model. And then we can continue, once the student has been fixed, we can continue further with model compression techniques such as convolutional kernel separation, deep compression pipeline, et cetera. In conclusion, we would like to thank Microsoft very much for this opportunity that they have given us. It was great to work and interact with all of you. Special thanks to Harsha, Pratik, Aditya, Professor Manik, and Don. And with that, I thank you all and open the floor to questions.